away for you this evening. We're going to hear from Claudio Ranieri ahead of the trip away to Brentford tomorrow evening. We've got another 60-second challenge on the way. We're going to look back at the FA Youth Cup action as well. A good result. Hello and welcome to Inside the Hive, a great show on the way for you this evening. We're going to hear from Claudio Ranieri ahead of the trip away to Brentford tomorrow evening. We've got another 60-second challenge on the way with Anne Meiwald. We're going to look back at the FA Youth Cup action, a great result for our youth team the other evening. Plus, we're also going to have a little bit of a Christmas theme as well. Welcome to Inside the Hive. Fingers crossed, satellites permitting, we're going to be joined by a Watford legend on the show very shortly. And as always, we've got another Watford legend in the studio in the name of Mr. Tommy Mooney. Tommy, how are you?
Very good. Good evening.
Good week so far?
Yeah, it's been okay. Quiet one. No golf this week.
No golf.
Before you even ask, I'm going to put it out there. No golf this week.
It's
too cold.
Weeks.
I'm having a rest.
Are you a fair weather golfer? Is this the problem?
No, not at all. It's a little bit of handicap protection. I'm hoping during the winter, the handicap goes up and I might have a chance of winning a few quid.
Love that. Right, as I mentioned, we're going to be joined, fingers crossed, satellites permitting, by Jay DeMerit a little bit later on in the show. So make sure you stick around for that. And as always, questions for our guests, you know how to do it by now. Pop them in the comments box below, wherever you're watching, and of course on Twitter as well, at Watford FC, and use the hashtag of InsideTheHive. Tommy, let's kick things off by chatting about performances over the last couple of weeks. We've mentioned on the show that there was this block of games that we just needed to get through. Some good performance was important. We've had that, and just let's get a reflection, especially Man City and Chelsea, the last couple of games we've had, you know, despite not picking up points, positives to take from those.
Yeah, I think if you look at that block as a whole, you obviously had the 3 points and a fabulous performance against United. And then I think you've had spells of a very good performance against three top teams in Leicester, Chelsea and Man City. So I think there's certainly a huge amount of positives from those performances. We know we've not got the results, but from those performances, I think there's a lot of optimism now going into the next block of four games that we've spoke about for a little while, but now they're here starting with tomorrow at Brentford.
Yeah, no, vastly looking forward to that. And we'll look forward to that game on the show a little bit later on. Okay, it seems as if the satellites have aligned. So we can head all the way to Vancouver right now because we're joined by Jay DeMerit on the show tonight. Jay, how are you?
Gentlemen, always a pleasure. How are you? Everything good?
Very good at this end. Good to have you on the show. Tommy's in the studio with us as well tonight. So Tommy's going to be firing questions at you. The fans are going to be asking lots as well. But we always like to kick things off with our guests that have, of course, played at the club. And your memories of your time at Watford, what really stick out for you?
Well, I mean, there's too many, to be honest. It was an incredible years at Vicarage Road. I think, you know, my best memory always is just walking up where you used to park. You know, that little walkway up Vicarage Road, dealing with the fans and talking to them. And it's just kind of a nice way to start our days at the stadium. That was always something I always remember, that walk up to Vicarage Road. I think from the game standpoint, of course, the promotion game in Cardiff, that's the one where we all know with that are at the back post. Of course, that one still lives in memory. I have the ball here. So I still get to relive that memory from time to time, and lastly, just captaining the club, you know, to be an American, to captain such a great club like Watford, and someone that's so community based like myself, like I was born and bred in Green Bay, Wisconsin, you know, community and sport go hand in hand, and I think, you know, I really enjoyed that part of what Watford Football Club is, and I think they're number one in community and sport in the UK, and I think you know, being a part of that, leading that team out for the many years that I did and for the many games I was fortunate enough to do so, I think are my top three for sure.
Yeah, that's amazing. Let's talk about the fan base across the pond, because in America and Canada, we saw the other week that you went to obviously Premier League Live there over in the United States. What's the love like for the Hornets over there?
Well, it's growing, you know, and that's really where my job starts. You know, as someone who that's from the States, again, part of my job is we're moving into kind of a North American ambassador role for the club, but which I hope will come and it is coming. But at the end of the day, it's first you got to create engagement, but I think the only way you do that is by creating a little bit of information and knowledge about the club. You know, a lot of people don't know the history of the club, and I think so. The first thing that we need to do is have a place where fans can go. And so one of my jobs is not only to engage with the already existing fan groups here in North America, but also to create new ones. And funny enough, I suppose I can announce it right now, but come Christmas, the 28th game against West Ham, we're heading live to Green Bay, Wisconsin. We're going to do the first ever Watford Football Club supporters group in Green Bay, Wisconsin. We've rented out a bar right next to Lambeau Field, which is going to be the home of the new Watford supporters group in Green Bay, and get the Packers involved and really show that bridge of community that I know and love from both places. And so we're going to start with that. And with there, you know, we educate, we start to teach them some of the fans, we start to introduce some of the players and the type of players they bring to the field. And so within that, then you start to create little mini fans. And so it's an all ages event. We're going to do a little football clinic around it. And so then we get the youth involved. And so then we start to hopefully plant seeds for the future of fans in the Premier League. And the final part is the club's job, and that's to stay in the Premier League, because Americans like the Premier League. I don't know if they follow the championship much. So that's the challenge from the other side of the pond side is make sure Watford stays in the league, and I'll do my job over here to start making sure there's more yellow in the stands.
No, that sounds like a great job. We love that. Look, Tommy, obviously it's, having fans across the world is incredibly special, isn't it? And obviously you're an ambassador for the club, just like Jay is as well. You know, that spreading that message in the word about the club's incredibly important and special for yourselves as former players, from having that connection of the fans in the terrace, being able to kind of communicate with that next generation of fans as well.
Yeah, I think we realise how important it is, and you know, I'm sure Jay has many, many memories and also stories of whenever we travel the world, whether it's with officially with the club or whether we're on holiday, there seems to always be a Watford supporter that's somewhere in that region, and they'll always discuss stories that of things of that happened. In my case, it might be a goal or two. Jay, I'm sure, is goals and tackles and winning medals. So all over the world, we know that they're there. It's just sometimes it doesn't have surprise you when they turn up.
No, it certainly does. Jay, me and Tommy were just talking, obviously, about the run of games recently. Me and Tommy was mentioning a couple of weeks ago that this kind of block was always going to be difficult, but actually positive performances and a handful of points wouldn't be too bad. And that's certainly what the team have done. And we're going to talk about the games coming up very shortly. But just get your assessment over the last few games. Of course, Chelsea, you know, I think everyone feels like we should have got something from that. But Man City at the weekend as well, we certainly didn't let ourselves down there either.
No, and I think the first thing that you can see is the positivity within the place. You know, you can see that Claudio's really got them in a good mindset where it's a team performance. You can see the energy for 90 plus minutes is there. And then you add the talent. And again, obviously it was sorry to see Sarr go down, because I think that top three is competitive. And we all know that the only way to stay in the Premier League is to score goals. And so that part for me is the most positive sign, you know, to see the scoring power that we have as we shore up the defense. I think, you know, again, there's been a lot of injuries at the back. That never helps anyone, because keeping clean sheets helps, of course. But, you know, I think for me, the most important sign is that we can score goals. You know, Dennis is showing sharpness in a lot of different areas of the park. I think, you know, Sarr comes back, we have fit. And King is good for a finisher too as well. So you know, that's the best part for me is that the scoring punch is there. And I think from there, it's just about playing together. Everyone knows that with a revolving door of players and managers, it's hard to keep that commonality, which is going to be consistent every week. And I think that now that commonality is starting to come. I think that, you know, Claudio is done a good job in creating a team environment. And now it's just about going and putting those consistent performances, because I think that's really been the lacking, you know. But it's hard to have consistent performances with new managers and new players every week. And so it's nice to finally see see that over the last 6 to 8 weeks, we can actually see similar players and a similar manager at the helm. And I think that all helps as to how you start to create consistency for the second half of the season.
Yeah, it certainly does. And that second half of the season pretty much seems like it's well and truly on its way. The festive football fixtures are well and truly starting to kick in over here. Tommy, are you ready for Christmas yet? I've obviously got your Christmas tree next to you in the studio today. You starting to feel festive yet?
Not as yet. No, I don't. I think it's always, Jay would tell you, as a footballer, you always look forward to Christmas because, you know, you have a little bit of time with your family. But it's also, there's so many games over a short space of time. And I think it's really where the league table starts to develop around the Christmas time. I don't really take much notice of it before now. And probably when you get to this point, the beginning of December, that's when you sort of see after 13, 14 games, you get the gist of what teams are doing and how they're playing and the structure that they have. So I think this is the start, certainly for me as a player, this was the start of the time of the season where you think, right, okay, I know what's going on here. Let's get into our group of games. And if you can pick up, you know, 3 wins on the trot can move you 10 places in the Premier League. We've seen that already. So, you know, it's one of those. It's that time for a footballer and as a player, you just want to be concentrated, prepare properly, because there's an awful lot of distractions. Prepare properly, but do your job as well as you can.
Okay, a very important question for you both now. Jay, I'm going to ask you this first. Have you ever been asked to switch on Christmas lights before?
Yeah, I did it at the Harlequin a couple, probably 10 years ago now.
Nice.
15
Tommy?
Years ago.
Equally, obviously a long time before you, Jay, but I've switched them on at the Harlequin and actually Swindon Town Centre.
Wow.
Not many people have done that. Swindon Town Centre, I turned the lights on. Myself and Sam Parkin.
Amazing. Well, there's 2 other people who have joined that elusive club of switching on Christmas lights then while involved with the club, because this week, Christian Kabasele and Helen Ward had the honour of turning on Watford's General Hospital's Christmas lights.
Hi, everybody. I'm here with Helen. Hello.
Hello.
And we go to the hospital for the Christmas illumination. See you later. Here is the button where we will push. And it's not a real button, it's a fake one.
Shh. 5, 4, 3.
A little bit wet, no problem. Nice. Helen, what do you think?
Beautiful.
Nice.
Best Christmas tree I've ever seen.
Just the weather is... Here it is, guys. I hope you enjoy. Again. Thank you.
There we go, Kristen and Helen there, turning on the Watford General Hospital Christmas lights. Tommy, obviously, it's been tough over the last year or so with COVID, and I know the club are always very, you know, important within the community, especially at Christmas time, going into the hospital and handing gifts out and bits and pieces. So nice to see that, although you can't get full back to all those things pre-COVID just yet, that there's still that community involvement and doing something for the hospital.
No, absolutely. I mean, we would always go as a group, as you'd expect from any of Graham Taylor's teams. We'd always go as a group, normally on a Friday, because, you know, the gaffer used to like to take you to the hospital. So you often realise just how lucky you are. And obviously the players with your young children, seeing the sick children in the hospital really makes you realise how fortunate you are in your own personal life. But if you can raise the spirits of those, and just like every other one of the initiatives that the club has, you know, whether it's calling people at home or visiting sick people in hospital, a little bit more difficult to do now, granted, but it's just something that we expect from Watford Football Club, isn't it? The community and the football club have always been linked together.
Jay, for yourself, of course, experience of playing here in the Premier League, you've always mentioned that important family feel here at Watford, but your time in America playing as well, is that something that's important over the pond as well with the community aspect?
Yeah. I mean, the football's not played in the winter here. And so most of the families are in their off seasons when it comes to Christmas time. The MLS Cup, I think, is this weekend. So again, most of the Christmas period is done beforehand because the seasons are done. But, you know, I think, you know, football more than ever it's important for us to understand that it's the fans that really are the lifeblood of what we do. Yeah, players will always fight for their contracts, but it's the people in the stands that will pick you up when things aren't going well. And they're the ones that are going to support you whether you win, lose, or draw. And I think, you know, I think that's really undervalued. And you know, I think to Tommy's point, you know, that whole humility side of once you start engaging with fans and having, you know, kids that are sick in front of you, it makes you understand about a lot of why we do what we do and how we can use our time on the field as inspiration to them, but also they're inspirational to us too, you know, at the end of the day. And I believe that when you get that connection together and you get that camaraderie where one is just as important as the other, but both feel that way, then you got that special formula. And I think Watford exudes that.
Yeah, no, Matthew, and of course, an incredibly special time of year for lots of people. And of course, you know, those people that are, you know, involved with those community aspects of the club, as the club is always there for you if you need anything. Those schemes that we've had in place, of course, during lockdown, if you need any extra help or assistance, it's always there at Christmas. I know, Tommy, you've done lots of bits in the past speaking to fans and stuff as well, so it's important to know that the club is there for everyone, which is really nice to see. Right, let's move things on to action back on the pitch, because of course we talked about it last week. We had Jimmy and Richard, of course, in the studio with us looking forward to the FA Youth Cup this week. Well, the good news is it was a victory. So let's take a look back at some of that action. Fantastic result there in the FA Youth Cup 2-1 victory with that late goal. Tommy, we've spoke before about the importance of the youth team, but a good victory like that is going to be a massive step forward and an experience for those younger players.
Really good performance and even better result. I think you can see there in the players' faces and the way that they celebrate. Two really good goals as well, by the way. You can see what the FA Youth Cup means to them. I don't think it means so much to people that haven't been involved in it, but it's certainly, as an under 18 player, it's as big a competition as you can hope for. There's the FA Youth Cup, and then there's playing in the under 23s, and then, you know, hopefully for some of them in the first team at some point. But I made my first ever time that I came to Vicarage Road was playing in the FA Youth Cup for Aston Villa on the day that I turned professional. So the FA Youth Cup has special links for me in this place.
Yeah, it must be. And Jay, for you, obviously, you know, you played your youth football over the other side of the pond, but you'll have fond memories of the FA Cup. And the FA Youth Cup is incredibly special to these youngsters, just as the main FA Cup is to players like yourself.
Well, yeah, and like Tommy said, you can see what it means to the players. You know, every time you knock somebody else out, you're one step closer to that trophy. And I think there is something special about that. You feel that, especially as you start to, you know, create a bit of a wave throughout a season. You start to pick up some of those FA Cup wins, and you see that end in sight, and it gets exciting. And so exciting, like Tommy said, there were some good goals there. I think they're a good young team, and it's always good to see W's on the board.
Yeah, and obviously Jimmy Gilligan and Richard Johnson, of course, running that academy now. You know, for you, we spoke about this on the show last week, but for you, Jay, obviously players of that calibre that know what the club is all about and know their own personal journeys with youth football and the club, it's important to have people like that at the helm, isn't it?
100%. You know, and I think, you know, when you're a young person and you know that the club is bigger than you, I think a lot of times young people forget that these days, is, you know, that there is that whole idea of making the most of your time at the club. And I think each step of the way, whether it's in a youth FA Cup or trying to make the first team, or now you're in the first team and you're trying to, you know, score against Chelsea, it's, for me, it's all the same. It's about representing the club and yourself at the best level possible. And I think every step of the way, again, this is the type of things you want to build a bigger and better club.
That certainly is. And a massive well done to the youth team. Best of luck in the next round. Okay, time for one of the highlights of Inside the Hive. It's Tommy's favourite part of the show as well. And Jay, you're going to, I'm sure it's going to be a favourite part for you as well. It's our section of the show where we play Ask Tommy. Now, the good news is, Jay, you're not going to be left out because we're going to play Ask Jay a little bit later on. But there are some questions for Tommy now, which may be related to you. They may be related to golf, related to Watford. And we'll see how Tommy gets on. We'll work out how many points he gets. And the challenge is then for you, Jay, to, with your questions a little bit later on, is to score more points. Tommy won for the first time last week. And if you did watch the show, Tommy did vehemently claim that he said an answer. When watching it back, Tommy, do you need to apologise that you didn't say an answer you thought you did? You just thought it?
No, I have no idea what you're talking about. Jay, I'll be honest with you. Your questions, don't worry about the quiz, because this is so loaded to make me lose. It's ridiculous. You'll be fine, Jay.
Right. Tommy, are you ready for this?
Don't even think about asking me how many miles it is to where Jay sat from where I'm sat.
Well, we'll see where we go. Question number one. Which major, we always start with the golf question, is Rory McIlroy yet to win?
US Open.
The Masters. Green jacket. You only said US Open because you thought you said it last week and you didn't say it last week.
I
That's why. You just didn't want to trip up. Right, nil pois so far. Okay, question two. Jay, our guest this evening, famously starred in a TV commercial for which famous car brand? Was it BMW, Mini or Toyota?
Toyota.
Toyota. Jay, is that the right answer?
Correct.
And I hear there's a fun story with this one. Can you enlighten us with your story with the filming with the Toyota?
Well, it was just this crazy one where it was like this whole, like, you're in your dream. So I had to like run past a burning building, and then I had to wear that green suit and run through a wall. And so it was like this full on actor, like stunt double thing, but I was like running through walls and running past burning buildings. So it was, I was actually in the mountains getting chased by like this 6-foot drone chasing me through the mountain hill, running in running shoes in the middle of the snow. So it was quite a fun shoot. And certainly interesting, but I got like a nice battle scar from running through that wall. It made me feel like a true Hollywood star.
I love that. That's incredible. That's awesome. And the good news is, Tommy, you got a point for that as well. Well done. 1 point so far. Question number three. Who did Jay make his USA international debut against? Was it A, Guatemala, B, Honduras, or C, Colombia?
Honduras.
He's gone for Honduras. Jay, the correct answer is?
Honduras.
Wow. The actual correct answer, according to the internet, is Guatemala.
Guatemala.
Yeah,
right.
I was going to say it's Guatemala. Yeah.
Oh, come on, Jay. Whose side are you on here?
I hate to correct a former footballer on their own stats, but unfortunately, yeah. The website says, yes, it was Guatemala. So no point on
it
that
is.
One.
I was thinking about my teammates. I had two teammates on my college team. One was from Honduras and one was from Guatemala, but I forgot that my first cap was against the Guatemala in Dallas, Texas.
I love that. Okay, still just 1 point for Tommy so far. Question four. What is the name of the single which Jay released in 2006? Is it A, Soccer, 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 B, Soccer Rocks, or C, Soccer Baby?
Soccer Rocks.
He's gone for Soccer Rocks. Jay?
When I arrive, I'm in the zone. Soccer Rocks. It's true.
Love that. Amazing. Available to download in all good places you get your music.
I downloaded 2 points. That, Jay. I did. Yeah, that's right up there with my Wham and my Elton John ones.
£10,000 for Cancer Research UK for that single.
Amazing. A great effort. Question five. Tommy so far has 2 points. For 3 points, Tommy, as the crow flies, because you have to fly, because you have to go across the Atlantic Ocean, from Watford right here in this very seat to Vancouver, how many miles is it as the crow flies? Is it 4,691? Is it 4,695? Or C, 4,680?
It's nearly 5,000 miles away and you're giving me a 4 mile difference.
Pretty much, yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, that could depend on the wind.
They're still the same miles.
And also...
How does the distance affected by the wind, Tommy? It's still the same measurement.
They have to go a little bit further. You should know that. Because you have to fly into the wind. You can't fly along the wind. Trust me, I know these things.
Okay.
I'm a qualified...
I need to push you an answer. This could mean you get 3 points rather than two.
It's the middle one.
You've gone for 4,695. Unfortunately, it's 4,691, so you were 4 miles out, unfortunately.
Is that from here in this chair?
As the crow flies. So it's See, 2 points.
I've gone from the end of the stadium because you can't land a plane in here, can you?
Of course you have.
You've got to walk up
He's
to the plane.
He's gone for the runway. 2 points. Jay, that puts you in good stead for a little bit later on, which is good news. But that's not the end of the questions, because now it's time to ask your questions to our guests in the studio tonight. As always, you know how to do this by now. Just put a comment box below in the comments box. And of course, if you're on Twitter as well, at Watford FC, use the hashtag Inside The Hive. So Jay, we're going to start off with some questions for you. This comes from WFC George, and it says, who is a Watford player that you like in this current squad? So out of the current bunch, who stands out for you?
I think Dennis right now is my front runner. I think he adds an incredible spark to this group. I think he's tricky. I think he's slight. I think he works hard. I think he's everything you want in a Premier League footballer. And so I would say he's the most exciting for me right now.
Nice. The next question comes from Jacob. What current Watford player for you, Jay, resembles your playing style the most?
I mean, no one with that technical ability. So we'll go back to the defense. I'll probably say Serralta. It'll be good to see him get fit again. I see him coming back. He's a bit of a hard, you know, he likes to get mixed in there. And I think he's a no nonsense type defender. And I think, that's the type of player I like to be.
Nice. Thank you very much for your question, Jacob. Next one comes from Luca Hall and Rudy Johnson saying, what was your favorite goal from your time at the club?
It's got to be the playoff final. You know, anytime you have an opportunity to score in front of 70,000+, it's an incredible feeling, and especially when it comes with a promotion. So, you know, I think that goal for me tops, I think, for my Watford for sure.
Awesome. Charlotte Gibson has got the next question. What more do you think the club could do to build a profile in North America? Obviously, you've mentioned, of course, the little fan group and fan hub you're setting up over there. What other things do you think that the club could do to broaden its love and appeal across stateside?
Yeah, I think, there's a whole slew of things. One is, of course, create that fan engagement, you know, to help people understand why Watford's amazing. You know, in all honesty, I think... you know, a lot of people, once you start throwing in Elton John's and some celebrity around it, I think that really helps. And again, like I had touched on, I think staying in the league really allows you to start to build that foundation where you fans here will continue to watch the games come in on Saturday and see the same players on the highlights. And I think that's really the key to all of it. You know, again, it's hard to get, a North American market to pay attention if you're not in the Big Six. But that being said, if you're there every week, for years and years, I think, again, that starts to create that commonality. Well, hopefully the boots on the ground are adding to more of the reason why you cheer for the club from a deeper standpoint. So I think it's a combination of those things. But I definitely think it's getting better. Again, I was at the Fan Fest in Miami 2 years ago, and I didn't see any Watford jerseys. And now to go to the one in L.A. a couple weeks ago and to see a few yellow shirts in the crowd was a step in the right direction. So, you know, keep going. And we're looking forward to helping build it.
No, Matthew, and we say we appreciate the work you're doing in your ambassadorial role as well. So thank you so much for all you're doing as well. Next question comes from Charlotte Gibson as well. And we can send this to both of you as well. So we'll kick off with Tommy on this one. What do you think about the number of games that teams have to play over Christmas? And for you, what was your most memorable Christmas as a player with performances? And is there a particular game, one Christmas, that sticks in your memory?
Um, I, from a footballer's point of view, I think I hope Jay'll agree. It's you want to play in the games. Training becomes monotonous and difficult, but you want to play in games every day. So it never concerned me whether it was Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Wednesday, whatever it was. I'd far rather play in a game than I would work in training. So it's one of those. I don't necessarily think that footballers should or would concern themselves with how many games they play. The fixtures are there to be played, hopefully to achieve something at the end of the season. So I'm not sure I have too many over the Christmas period memories. I think I scored a goal maybe Boxing Day here to West Brom one year, that one of two goals, but I'm only guessing that because I think it was really cold and there was a little bit of snow about, so I'm not sure whether that was Christmas time.
Love that. Jay, same to you. Your question, same question to you.
Well, my best Christmas memory was my second season. I had 17 demerits come over for the first time. They had never been to the UK before, and we did the demerit family Christmas there. My grandmother paid for the whole family to go. She was retired and had a larger pension and was at the end of her life, and she's like, what am I doing with this money? I'm going to spend it. So she paid for my whole dad's side to come to the UK, and we rented out a few Airbnbs and had a good old English Christmas for the first time in my second season. So that's my best Christmas memory. And what was the other question?
Just regards to the amount of games that, obviously, from a fan's perspective, we love it because it's non-stop football. But for you as a player, is that something you relish?
We love it too. I'm with Tommy. I'd much rather be on the field than at the training ground. And I think, you know, what I love about the Christmas period, and just what I love about these little chess matches throughout a season, is that this is the time where you got to use your squad. This is the time you can figure out, you know, carrying injuries and things like that. So I think it's all part of that chess match of a 50 plus game season if you go well. And I think that really just adds to it. You know, you put all these, concentrated games in within a couple weeks, 10 days, and all of a sudden, you know, again, you will win those three games too. You find yourself near the top of the table just over a Christmas period. So I think there's good shifts within a season that can happen over the Christmas time. And, you know, again, that's what I hope happens now over the next five games from Watford. And I think they got a good chance to pick up a lot of points now coming through the Christmas period.
Now, fingers crossed. And the final question for the moment, more chances for your questions throughout the show. So make sure you keep sending them in. This one to you, Jay. Are Green Bay going to win the Super Bowl?
If they can stay healthy, they got as good a chance as anybody. You know, the big, you know, like the big teams like Chiefs and things aren't as well as they doing as well as they used to. So, you know, I think they're as good as anybody. If Aaron Rodgers can stay healthy and keep COVID off his health, then I think we could have a chance.
Tommy, Green Bay got a chance?
Yeah, I'm with Jay.
Love that. I've tried so hard to get into American football. And I really, really want to get into it, but I always fall asleep. I need to actually go to a game, I think, to really get into the NFL.
I actually had a Green Bay Packers shirt when I was in my early teens, I think because it looked like a cheese and onion packet of crisps. Maybe that's why I was attracted to it. No idea why. I didn't even watch NFL at the time. It wasn't on the TV here, Jay, but I had a Packers shirt.
Nice. I love that. Maybe we need to come over and go to a game with you, Jay. We'll come and do an Inside the Hive special and we'll go to a game.
100%. Well, I'm actually going on Christmas Day. The Packers play the Browns. It's my first ever Christmas game, actually going to Lambeau Field on Christmas Day. So I'll bring it because we got the Watford event just 3 days later on the 28th for the West Ham game at the place across the street. So you'll get some Lambeau footage coming soon.
Love that. Very much looking forward to that. Okay, more questions from you a little bit later on in the show. But time now for another installment of our 60-second challenge. Lots of players have taken this on so far. Next up, though, it's the turn of Anne Meiwald.
I'm Anne Meiwald, and this is my 60-second challenge.
iPhone or Android?
Android.
If you could change position, where would you play?
Striker.
Morning person or night owl?
Morning.
Team you supported as a kid?
And Bayern Munich.
Last minute winner or hat-trick?
Last minute winner.
Favourite TV series?
Grey's Anatomy.
Matchday superstition?
I don't have any.
Teammate with the worst dance moves?
Bing. Chandler.
Studs or blades?
Studs.
Worst thing about pre-season?
Running.
Coach or train to away games?
Coach.
Most famous person on your phone?
Frank Kirby.
Best dish you can cook?
Spag bol.
Favourite holiday destination?
Thailand.
30-yard screamer or solo goal?
Solo goal.
Red sauce or brown sauce?
Red sauce.
If you could play a musical instrument, what would it be?
Guitar.
Fancy restaurant or takeaway?
Takeaway.
Penalty shootout in a final, would you go first or last?
First.
Favourite food?
Thai red curry.
Football Manager or FIFA?
FIFA.
Text message or phone call?
Text message.
Netflix or Prime?
Netflix.
Favourite musician or group?
Two Door Cinema Club. I'll take that. Not at the bottom, well, down there, but we'll take it.
There we go. Second in the table to Ben Foster, 22 points. Ben's still top of the tree on 23 points. We'll see as we go through the season how that leaderboard progresses. Talking about top of the tree, Tommy, a quick word on our Christmas tree, new addition this week.
Yeah, it needs feeding up a little bit. However, it is so cold in the studio, we've got penguins in here.
I love that.
Take one of those home.
Well, this is an idea. If you're watching the show, to be fair, I saw some stuff on the Instagram the other day where some young Watford fans had made their own Christmas tree decoration. So if you're watching this and you're a bit good with the arts and crafts, why not send us a Christmas decoration and send it to the ground? You might want to draw a little, we could actually make a version of you, Tommy, instead of the little Santa. So if you're creative and you're watching this, send us a Christmas decoration in. Just send it to the Vicarage Road Stadium, and you never know, we might put it on our tree next week.
Make sure it's not too heavy, because I'm not sure that the tree will take all of that much weight.
Light materials only for that. Right, okay, lots coming your way here from the club over the next few weeks. Of course, tomorrow evening, 8 o'clock kickoff. Brentford is the destination for us. 8 o'clock kickoff, as I said. Stay tuned to all the club channels for that exclusive build-up and reaction. Tommy, once again, will be on commentary for that, so make sure you don't miss it. Burnley versus Watford on Wednesday the 15th of December. That one coming up as well. Lots of games in quick succession, as we said. 7:30 kickoff, as always. Tommy will be on that one as well. Wrap up warm for that. Burnley's always cold. Stay tuned to the club channels. And then another trip down memory lane for the manager. Another trip to Leicester City in the third round of the FA Cup. Weekend of the 8th and 9th of January. Fixture details and ticketing arrangements to be announced in due course. So keep an eye on that one. Talking of the FA Cup, the Vitality Women's FA Cup. The Golden Girls will be in action versus Coventry United. That one on Sunday the 12th of December. 3 o'clock kickoff on that. Also coming your way, if you're in the club shop and fancy getting yourself a little bit of a bargain, 25% off baby wear. A bit too small for me and Tommy, but there we go. Offer ends on Monday, December the 13th. If you want to get that, shop.watfordfc.com. A great place to pick up your Watford gifts this Christmas. Now, talking of things coming your way, something very special coming up now, because you need to stay tuned to our official YouTube channel, because Jay DeMerit, our very own Jay, who's on the show today, has got a very special new show coming up. Here is what's in store.
I want to introduce to all the Watford faithful, my roommate at the World Cup, one of my favorite people of all time, my friend and colleague, Stuart Holden of the U.S. national team, now with Fox Sports here in America. How you doing, Stu?
Up the Hornets. I mean, that's what I used to have to hear you say every time we roomed together.
And so talk a little bit about when you land, you know, as a young American, or American, I'll put those in quotations. You know, as you moved into the game, what were the first things you noticed about the UK, the culture of the game, the locker room, those types of things as you got into those locker rooms?
I think that you could tangibly feel the pressure. I would like feel it from Bolton fans, and there would be kind of off-color remarks, and it might have been banter, but you know that banter that's like banter, but it's not really banter. It's just a nice way of saying it, like, hey, you were pretty crap yesterday, right?
Again, that there is an art form. I agree that the English really appreciate that. 100%. And, you know, and again, and thanks to, you know, that was it. That's the only questions I got today. But, you know, we could chatter about this for hours. But
You came with the easy ones today, but the softballs, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, it's all part of the growth of the game. You know it.
Up the Hornets.
Well, there we go. A little sneak peek at a brand new series coming to the official YouTube channel. If you're not subscribed already and you're watching this on YouTube right now, do make sure you hit that subscribe button. Jay, tell us a little bit about this then, this new series that's coming. Very much looking forward to this.
Well, you know, it's a part of the growth, you know, and I think, you know, guys like Stu, who have understood the UK system for a long time, he's a great personality. Again, he's got a very large following here in North America. He's a great guy, and I think at the end of the day, it's those types of people that help with the growth of the game. It's if there's good storytelling within the walls, I think part of it too, and all credit to the Ted Lassos of the world, is that, you know, it really does help teach what British football culture is all about. You know, at the end of the day, say what you want about Ted Lasso, but there's a lot of North Americans I see that are paying way more attention to the Premier League now because of it. And they do get that mix right of how do you mix it, you know, a true North American sport culture, which again defines a lot of this world's sports scenes, you know, but how do you integrate that into what the Premier League's all about and English football for that matter. And the culture of that for me is what's most interesting. So we're going to dive into the culture of that and the why and how that across the pond we can appreciate each other.
Okay. If you like Ted Lasso, you just got to believe. That's what it's all about, right, Jay? You just got to believe.
Right.
Too right. Tom, is Tommy going to feature at some stage? Can we get Tommy on the podcast at some point to share his experience of the English game?
100%. And the golf game. We'll get him live from the links or something.
Love that. Just don't ask him who's won what Masters and Majors in the US. He's not quite sure. But a good talker, Tommy. It'll be good. We've got you a gig. I'll be your agent as well.
Thanks very much.
No problem.
Better agent than Question Master, anyway.
I love that. Right, still plenty to come on the show tonight. Make sure you check out Jay's series, of course, coming very, very soon. But of course, Tommy, you've been busy as well, because another new little feature coming very soon as well, called How Smart Are the Hornets? It's going to feature Tommy, Noel Gifton, Women's Williams Takes Part, Tom Cleverley, William Troostekong, and here's a little short clip of what to expect.
Okay, well, listen, you get a go on the dartboard. Here we go, extend your lead. Oh, hello. No one say anything. No one say anything.
Okay, yeah, do you want to explain that one?
Somebody was moving that dartboard. That way, Gifton and I had turned up. And I'll get his name right, Gifton Noel Williams.
Yeah, sorry.
We turned up, we hadn't had a stretch, we hadn't warmed up. And so fine for Gifton, because he's still quite a young man.
Yeah.
At my age, you need a warm up. That was the first time I'd kicked the ball, and in a long time.
Yeah.
And it was extremely ineffective.
No, true. And to be fair, that was a little bit of unfair of us to play that one. So here is the proper promo of what to expect.
Right, let's see how you have a go on the dartboard. You ready to go?
Yeah.
You got 10 seconds.
10 seconds.
3, 2, 1, go.
Do this, mate. Do your right foot. Do your right foot.
Oh, left foot. That was embarrassing, Tommy. Come on, man.
Oh, I love it on that attempt. It was the ball's fault. The dartboard was moving on the first one. Ball was too soft on the second.
It was flat, that ball. Time we had it pumped up, and then you see it'd be very interesting for the supporters to watch what happened in the end. It was a close competition.
No, it was. And all joking aside, it's well worth a watch, so make sure you do check that out in the coming weeks as well. Chris Stark hosts that one. It's good fun, obviously. Current players, obviously, having Tommy and Noel on it as well is wicked. So
Gifton Noel Williams.
Oh, okay, it's been a long day, we're getting there. There's lots of things going on. We've got satellites.
I mean, I'm embarrassed for missing the target now, but
I'm embarrassed,
but I'm sure Noel will forgive you.
Thank you, Gifton. Right, time now then for the next round of our questions. This time, of course, Jay, it is your turn on the show this evening. 2 points is what Tommy got. All you have to do is beat two. So fingers crossed, you may do better, but if not, it'll be a second win in 2 weeks for Tommy. So Jay, your first question is this. You captained Watford for the first time on the 9th of December 2006 in a home game, but who was it against? Was it Reading, Wolves or Bolton?
Reading.
Correct. 1 point on the board. Question two. You scored your first goal for the club on the 15th of January 2005. You scored Watford's third in a 3-1 victory. But who was it against? Scunthorpe United, Crewe Alexandra or Wigan Athletic?
Crewe Alexandra.
Correct. 2 points. Two questions. 2 out of 2. Will it be 3 out of 3? Your third question is this. You were named as one of the three candidates for Watford's 06-07 Player of the Season Award. Unfortunately, you didn't win it, but who did?
Ben Foster.
Correct. You didn't even need a clue. That's good. I love that. Question four. The Vancouver Whitecaps. According to Wikipedia, how many games did you play for them? 69, 71 or 76?
76.
No, that's wrong.
Go on, Tommy.
Do I get a bonus point?
No. but you can show off your intelligence of how good you were on Wikipedia earlier.
71.
Correct. Correct. Jay, Tommy's got quite good at this, of Googling the guests just in case before, just to make it less awkward when they're not in the studio. It's all right.
Jay, I'm going to be honest with you. I thought we had Adam Messina coming in, so I Googled his birthplace. I Googled Bologna because that's where he came from. I Googled everything with Adam Messina. It never crossed my mind to Google how far it is to Vancouver from here. So apologies, but I did tell you your questions would be easier than mine.
Got to keep yourself on the toes with this show. Got to keep yourself alert. Your final question, you can get 4 points on this one, though. You signed for Watford from Northwood FC. From this very seat, to Northwood FC with the fastest route, not as the crow flies like Tommy's question, fastest route according to the maps on my phone. How far is it? Is it A, 4.2 miles, B, 4.7, or C, 4.9?
Stay in the middle. I'll go 4.7.
Correct. 4.7. Yeah. That's a good effort. Jay, you are this week's winner. But actually, on that last question, tell us a bit about this one, because this is an interesting story. And I spoke about this with Tommy, and he said with the recruitment stuff, sometimes this is a regular thing that happens. But as a kind of a fan's perspective, this is a really interesting story of how you signed for the club.
Yeah, well, it was because of Scott Fitzgerald, who they had signed the year before from Northwood. And so I was playing for a team called Southall Town. For a guy called Del Dinas, who's now passed away from ALS, and RIP to Del, but he moved to Northwood for that next preseason. And so he calls me up. He's like, we got Watford in a preseason friendly that they gave because Scott Fitzgerald ended up being the leading scorer of Watford that year, coming off the bench, and he added a bunch of goals. And so they gave Northwood another preseason friendly as a thank you for signing Scott on a free. And so basically my coach calls me, he says they're bringing I think Watford had just won the Algarve Cup. I don't know if you guys fans remember that, but they had just won it, and Sean Dyche had brought this little trophy from the Algarve, and they put the first team out. And so I played against Heider Helgeson and Bruce Dyer in a friendly, and thankfully those guys gave me a bit of a challenge, and I was up for it. I knew I was prepared for that game, and knew that the big boys were coming into town, and I think they filled the three rows of stands with a couple hundred people. So it was definitely the most amount of people I had played in for the UK. You know, I had been there for almost a year, so it was my first kind of big game that I thought, oh, I could go and do something here. And thankfully after that, Ray Lewington famously talks to Dell and he says, hey, we're looking for center backs. We got Neil Cox, Sean Dyche, and a couple other guys that were kind of towards the end of their careers, and they were looking for young free blood. And so there I was, a 23-year-old American, playing for 40 pounds a game at the time. And that was exactly what I needed. I needed an opportunity to show England what I had, and an opportunity for me to grow the game and grow my game, and everybody won in that situation. You know, Watford got a free player that they could take a chance on, and I got an opportunity to be eventually who I became. And so, you know, it was those moments, I think, you know, we all look at in our careers of where it could go either way, but that one certainly put me into a whole new stratosphere.
And Tommy, like we were talking about this, you know, you sometimes see that teams play each other in a pre-season friendly and a particular player stands out, and you know, that fairy tale can come true.
Yeah, absolutely. I've heard stories of it before, and you know, Jay's a prime example. There's always, you'd always talk to, when you speak to young players, you always say there's always somebody watching you. And ironically, sometimes it happens that even in pre-season, squads are not fixed. The manager still doesn't know what his best team is in pre-season. If another player on the opposition catches his eye, I'm sure there's not too many gone to do as well as Jay did from Northwood to Watford, but still, I dare say I've known of it happening before. And say you've always got a chance. There's always somebody watching. Remember that, young players out there.
No, massively great bit of advice that. Right, time for some of your questions as well. Pete Jones has sent one in. A question for you, Jay. Of course, from a defensive perspective, the question is, do you think goalkeepers feel left out of goal celebrations? But I guess we can have that from a defender's point of view as well. When Tommy's up top claiming all the glory, do you bum up the pitch 60, 70 yards and then have to worry about getting back to kick off? Or do you just let him get on with it and go, yeah, come on, let's refocus?
Yeah, usually I use that as a time to rest. I'm not going on. I have to take this for 35 seconds, get my breath, and get back to business. But depends on the goal scorer, depends on the goal celebration, depends on the goal. You know, if it's a Lloyd Doyle back post header, I'm celebrating with everybody in that stand for sure. But if it's Tommy and he scores every week, then yeah, good job, Tommy. I'll see you at the halfway line.
Tommy, obviously you score plenty of goals in your career. Did you ever get goalkeepers coming up to try and join in? Or defenders that were miles away that had no right to be that high up the pitch?
Yeah, not too often goalkeepers, but defenders. Yeah, I think it shows the team unity. I think you can always, if it's a last minute of a game and it's a winner, then you expect everybody to pile in. But I think sometimes, if I wear my recruitment hat, sometimes you can see how popular the player is when the amount of players that celebrate with him. But I can honestly say we were so organised under Graham Taylor here that when the defenders celebrated, we had to make sure that one of us stayed in their half of the pitch so the defenders could get back in their positions for the kickoff. So even celebrations were organised under the gaffer.
Oh, I love that. So Tommy thought he was a popular member of the squad, but really it was just the gaffer telling everyone to celebrate.
That's right.
Love that. Thank you for your question, Pete. Next one comes from Andrew. It's a two-part to this one. We'll kick off with the first part for you, Jay. Who is the best footballer at the club right now, in your opinion?
Yeah, again, I'm gonna go with Dennis right now. I think he's coming into his own now. I think he's sharp. He's smart. I like his runs off shoulders. I think he's tricky in the box, and I think he gives the defenders fear. And I think anytime you have a player up front that can put in fear, Sara was someone that I think adds to that. And then I think it gives open up an opportunity for other people to score some goals too. So I think him right now.
Yeah, and Tommy, obviously. Dennis there for Jay. Obviously, we've spoken over the week, so there's quite a few players at the moment that could easily take that title.
Yeah, I think there's influential players in the team and you need that to succeed as a team. I think down the middle, I've been really impressed with Moussa Sissoko, Josh King playing the middle of the pitch, whether he goes wide and then Dennis comes into the middle of the pitch. Obviously, we're missing Ismail Assar, but all over the pitch, you need characters in a dressing room and those characters tend to show on a match day and on the pitch. So it's not one individual that we need them to come together as a team and play how they have done in the last couple of weeks for small periods of the games.
Mm-hmm. Second part of the question from Andrew is, who is your favourite Watford player ever? Jay, let's start with you. If it's a player you've played with, great, but if not, you can pick someone that just has inspired you, that's pulled on the favourite, the famous yellow and black jersey.
Definitely Super Ben. Ben Foster's, obviously I was fortunate enough to play him through many years, so got promotion with him, shared a lot of moments with him. But I just, I love his positivity. I think he's a great guy, not only as a player, but also just someone that's around the locker room, genuinely the nicest man in football. So I'm giving that to Ben.
Nice. For you, Tommy?
I think if we're talking about one that I played with, Heide Helgerson was very, very good partner as a striker and then went on to after I left to do well for Watford, so I'd have to say H.
Nice, awesome. Thank you very much for all your questions. Really appreciate it as always. Of course, whenever we're on live with Inside the Hive, just get in touch via the comments box below. Always good to have your questions. Thank you so much for taking the time to ask one on tonight's show. Okay, let's look forward to the action then coming up, because tomorrow night is our next game. We are away to Brentford. We're going to look forward to that game next. But first of all, let's hear from the manager, Claudio Ranieri.
So I knew that there was a pre-season friendly match and we lost here 3-1. Then I know against Brentford it will be a very tough match, but we are ready. We are ready to fight against everybody now.
I guess the expectation from some supporters will be to see you attack and go for these teams, but you mentioned there about Brentford scoring 3 goals in the friendly. They scored 3 goals against Liverpool, for instance, this season. Yeah. I guess it's important to get the balance right in these matches and against Brentford defensively and offensively.
Yes, of course. Brentford played very well, is managed very well. Well done to the coach. They have a very good triangulation. They go straight away forward. It's well organized, but also we are well organized. We are ready for this battle.
Well, there we go then, the thoughts of Claudio Ranieri ahead of the game tomorrow. Tommy, we mentioned a little bit earlier on that block of games. We now move on to another set of games against Brentford. As the manager said there, they're going to be organised. But how do you expect this game to play out tomorrow?
I think it'd be a good game for us. I think playing on the Friday night always gives you the chance to put the points on the board before everybody else as well. You know, the biggest game in the country tomorrow. So, yeah, it'd be well attended, well viewed on TV. So it's a big game. And I think everybody in the country has a lot of respect for Brentford because of such a small club in the past, finally getting to the Premiership. But we've got to show them, you know, why we got promoted last season and take the game to them. They're struggling with injuries a little bit. But you see, Thomas Frank's done an absolutely outstanding job, as has the recruitment staff there in the players that they've signed. And they thoroughly deserve their promotion to the Premier League. We've just got to make sure that this new stadium tomorrow is celebrated from the Watford supporters, not the Brentford ones.
No, certainly. And Jay, from your perspective, of course, we mentioned, of course, that block of games that's been. We look forward to this next set of games now. Important not to get complacent, but important at the same time that we take those performances forward to get the results when we're playing against teams that we kind of maybe perceive as slightly more winnable.
100%. And, you know, everyone knows that this past period weren't really points that we were supposed to pick up. Obviously, we'll take bonuses from Manchester United, things like that. Those are the big performances that'll continue through the season. But that being said, you know, these are the points that you have to take. You know, these are the most important ones. This is when you look at the schedule throughout the season, you go, oh, that period before Christmas is a point or a place where we could pick up points. And so, you know, I definitely think that's the mindset in that locker room going into Christmas. These are winnable games. These are three pointers. And now you got to go out and actually do it. And I love that. And how, you know, Claudio says we're ready to fight now for every game from now on. I think he's confident in his group. I think he, you know, judging by that, he's been looking at his squad and seeing that his squad is starting to play well together. They're starting to understand it. They're starting to really come together. And hopefully that now can transfer into 3 points because it's going to have to.
Yeah, no, massive. Of course, Brentford promoted last season along with us as well. You mentioned, obviously, players there, someone like Ivan Toney. By the sounds of it, he's not going to be involved tomorrow. Obviously, that's an added bonus when they're missing a star player.
He's their biggest attacking threat. So, obviously, if he's not on the team sheet, that'll give the defenders a wry smile because he's, you know, the majority of their attacks go through him at some point. And you see from the penalty spot, you know, his success rate is exceptional. So if he's not playing, and we don't know whether he is or whether he isn't. So I think that from the dressing room's point of view, that's what they have to concern themselves with what's on the team sheet. You see, he gets all sorts of goals. If that's missing from Brentford's team, and added to the fact that, you know, if Charlie Goode and Janssen and Pinnock are their three centre-halves, even more important that our front three go and attack them because they're very similar to most of the Premier League teams that we talk about. They attack better than they defend. So I'll be looking forward to seeing our front three tomorrow.
And Jay, how do you prepare for that? So a potential fixture there where the star man for the opposition isn't available. Obviously, your prep work during the week, you're going to be focused on, you know, what's their best side to show them on to give you the advantage. How does that work when someone might be missing? Is it just a bit more homework and just looking into who else might play there?
Yeah, I think, but you know, a lot of times you get excited about that when their star player is not on the field. That gives you a little bit of a boost too. That being said, there's prep involved, of course, you know, making sure that set pieces are still tight because of the big threat. Normally, you do pay more attention because of that big threat. And when that big threat's taken off the field, sometimes maybe you do get a little bit complacent. So I would definitely, you know, make sure that people are reminded of their new jobs, their new ability to now that the star's off the field. And so there's certainly some prep there, some mentality boosts to make sure that you're still on point.
And finally then, Jay, looking forward to this one. Of course, lots of good performances from the side over the last few weeks. How do you see the rest of the season panning out for the Hornets?
Well, again, I think taking them in stages, you know, from now to the end of the Christmas period, if they take care of business over the next, you know, 3 to 4 weeks, I think they're going to be in a much different place. And I think that really should be the focus right now. Making sure that these are winnable games, picking up points where you can throughout the Christmas period, using that squad, hopefully now getting a couple guys back from injury to help with that squad. And I think Watford will hopefully find themselves in a good place just after January.
Yeah, massively, Tommy. A few players coming back into the side, so some winnable fixtures coming up. Positive with how things are going to go over the next few weeks?
Yeah, massively. But that increases if you get that first block of four. The last four we had, we got 3 points against Manchester United. Go and get 3 points in this next block of four games, then that gives us that initiative and impetus to go into those games. ending with Wolves away on Boxing Day. You know, if we can take 9 points out of those 12, that 12 available, we'd be more than happy.
No, certainly worse. It's going to be a busy time for the squad, busy time for players, busy time for Tommy on commentary duty as well. Jay, thank you so much for joining us all the way from Vancouver on the show tonight. Pleasure to have your company.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me. We'll see you from Lambeau over Christmas.
No, massively. Yeah, thank you very much for joining us, Jay. Tommy, thank you to you as always. Enjoy your trip to Brentford tomorrow night. Not too far from here, but a bit of a trek for you.
Yeah, but Friday night is fine. What else am I going to do? Yeah.
Too right. Amazing. Thank you very much to you, as always, for watching Inside the Hive. Always great to have your company on the show as well. We will be back next Thursday, so we'll see you then.